Okay, guys, we going to have the 13 lectures, and I'd like to show you guys about the pictures that you have in the midterm examination. The first one is the problem number one, and you may see they are not much different, and the tone of the problem is not that hard. And then the second picture, this is my problem, I decided. And again, if you take a look, the top one is from the textbook and the bottom one is for my problem. I don't think it's going to be tough for you guys. And the last one is pretty close. This problem is about the torsion. And also I post the solution to the third problem. So you guys can check whether you can do it or not, or at least you may study about it and learn how do you do it. If you do it well, okay, I'm happy with it. If you want, you can have a chance to correct it. Okay, and the score supposed to, for my problem, announced next week. I will play your work within this weekend. And I like to lecture you the second thing for the final examination. For the midterm examination, we have 5 chapters. But for the final examination, you guys gonna have 7 chapter. That is going to be chapter 6, 7, and 8 from textbook, and 9, and then 11, 12, and 13. The total of 7 chapters within 6 weeks. So you're going to have a lot of work to review your old stuff from the in-static, from the in-graphic, or even the mathematics. And then you use this knowledge to further your education on this subject. And what's going to be the problem? Based upon the midterm examination of 40%, you still have 50% for the final examination. The first problem is going to include the total of 2 or 3 chapters over here. And that is going to be 10 points. And on this problem, I'd like you guys to go back to review the pink letters. First, review about the free body diagram, okay, of the beam, of the frame, of the machine. And then practice to determine the reaction by using a proper equation of equilibrium. And again, review the free body diagram to determine the internal forces and internal moment. By doing this, internal forces is going to be the axial force, shear force. The internal moment is going to be the bending moment. Let me show you guys a very simple one. You got the beam, and then your beam have the force at the middle. Okay, that means you guys gonna have this one. And this is on what you learned from the previous course. One support must be the pin. Another one must be the roller. By using this, you may draw the free body diagram under this 10 kilonewton, and it's at the middle. Let's say this is 2 meters, this is 2 meters. You can determine, let's say this is A sub X, this is A sub Y. If this one is B, it's gonna be B sub Y. Okay, that is gonna be the free body diagram. And then you use the summation of x sub x equal to 0. the A sub x is 0. And if you summation of the moment about A equal to 0 over here, you guys will have the B sub y time this length of 4 meters. So it's going to be 4B sub y. That is going to be in this counterclockwise direction. This 10 kilonewton will rotate in the opposite direction. 10 gonna time 2. So the B sub y is going to be 20 divided by 4. That is going to be 5 kilonewton. And the last one, you can use the summation of F sub y equal to 0. So upward is positive. So A sub y plus 5 is going to be 10. So A sub y is going to be 5 kilonewton. This is going to be the first one. And then if you cut this one at 1 meter, so you can draw the free body diagram over here. This is 1 meter. And based on what you has from the previous one, this is going to be 5 kilonewton. And the cut over here, okay, going to develop the internal forces and internal moment. By doing this, you can review the engine static, and then you will learn this going to produce the internal moment and also the internal shear force. The N is going to be 0 because the A sub x is 0. And by doing this, the same thing, you may do summation of F sub y equal to 0. This is going to be the shear force. The downward is positive. So V downward 5 kilonewton upward, that is going to be 5 kilonewton. And then you do the summation of the moment at this point, not at this point, okay? And then equal to 0. Following this counterclockwise direction is positive. Your M is going to be 5 times 1, that is 5 kilonewton meter. That's, I ask you to go back and try to review it. And based on this, on the chapter 6, the 5 kilonewton meter, that's going to be the moment here, gonna produce the moment. Let me tell you, and you may remember from now, the stress that due to the bending moment is going to be the moment time y divided by I, okay? Based on this, M is the moment, okay? I is the moment of inertia. You have a moment, the lecture on the moment of inertia from the engine static. So this is going to be the moment that's produced what's so-called the fractional normal stress. Okay, that is going to be the third one, asking you to find the various stresses. One is going to be the normal stress. The normal stress due to the moment, we call it fractional stress. And then you have the shear force. This 5 kilonewton shear force is going to go to chapter 7. This shear force is going to be shear, the shear force time Q divided by I and T. Okay, what the variable do you know? This is shear force. This is moment of inertia. This is going to be the width of the section, the Q. I will tell you later, the same as the Y. We will discuss it later. That is going to be the equation for the chapter 7. And then you come to the result. You're gonna draw what's so called the stress element. Okay, that means the element, stress element is the element of the material on the cutting point. And the final result from this one going to be one is going to be the normal stress, whatever is going to be compression or tension by discuss the normal stress due to the moment. And then you have the shear stress due to the shear force is pointing downward. So the shear stress when it occur is will occur four of them. I tell you the lesson about this from the first chapter. This called the stress element. And the problem number one can be two dimension, as I show you over here, or is also can be in three dimension. Okay, I will show you about the three dimension later on the next slide. This is what you gonna study. But anyway, if you can do these two steps without doing the last two steps, you supposed to get like three or four point from the own knowledge. Okay, before you may get this for 6 or 7 point. So at least go back and review what you should know and take some score from the problem, even though you don't have any knowledge about chapter 6 and about chapter 7. Okay, the chapter 8 is the combination of chapter 6, chapter 7, and go back to chapter 5, chapter 1. And then the second problem. I like you guys, why Ajahn talking about this? I'm confused. I like you guys to know the big pictures of this course before we learn it. And then later, when you finish each chapter or two chapters, 6, 7, you may come to this video clip and review what the problem in the final examination is going to be, and you will get used to with the question that's going to ask you. And then we come to the second. Actually, the second problem will use the stress element in practical work and do the stress transformation. But usually, Ajahn will aware about what you may make a mistake. If we require you to use the obtained stress element here, work on the second problem. If you get the wrong answer, you will lose the second problem also. But by this one, Ajahn will give you the stress element. Okay, so by doing this, what it means, you will have the stress in this direction. And by setting, this is X, this is Y, this is gonna be the sigma sub X, and this is gonna be sigma sub Y. And also this shear stresses is in the XY plane, so it's going to be tau sub XY. What we have is they're going to give us a specific angle for the stress transformation. For example, if they ask you, this is the X direction and this is the Y direction, and they ask you to rotate this one for a given angle. Why, Ajahn? Why they do the stress transformation over here? What happened is when you test the beam by putting the force like this, what we have is the crack occur on the beam is not along the cutting plane. So what it means is the stress element that you determine by cutting this pen cannot be used to predict the crack occur on the beam. That's why you got to learn how to rotate the stress element. So this is going to be the stress element that represent the crack, okay, in this direction. So you got to rotate it by a given theta angle. And this is going to be X palm. And this rotation gonna be Y palm. And then the element, actually you got to dock it over here. Since you cannot dock it over here, it's going to make mess up everything. So you may extend it out to be here. And the stress, you're going to have the equation, or you may use the Mohr circle. That is going to be sigma sub X palm. This is going to be sigma sub Y palm. And this is going to be tau sub X palm, Y palm. They're going to ask you to determine the new stress of stresses. Okay. And then this is used for what? To determine the crack. Since you don't know actually the angle of the crack until you test it, somehow you have the way to calculate this one, principal stresses, and its associated angle. What is the principal stresses? That is going to the maximum normal stress, okay? It's going to go to occur at the theta sub P1 for sigma 1 and theta sub P2 for sigma 2. And this principal stress usually cause the crack of the brittle material such as the cast iron. So we determine the principal angle to check the crack of this cast iron. When you also have another material that we call the ductile material. The ductile material, when it fails, is different from the metal material. Is failed by the maximum in plane shear stress. Ductile material such as steel or aluminum, and the maximum in plane shear stress is occur with the average normal stress. And by doing this, you got to determine the angle that's produce the positive maximum shear stress. And another one, the angle that's produce the negative maximum shear stress. So maximum shear stress can be positive and negative. You got to determine the angle in order to predict the crack. And you got to determine the value of the tau max to compare with the mechanical property of the material. That is another 10 point. And usually, since the second problem use the Mohr circle, and Mohr circle can put into the computer program, you can coding the let's see, for trans, and since it can be coding, so the second problem, the problem gonna be very stepwise. Just follow the step, you will get the answer. And then we come to the third and fourth. The third and fourth, they come together. The problem is about the design of statically determinate beam. When you finish this one, okay, you may be able to design the column. You may be able to design the beam. So you also can analyze the task. You can design the task from the chapter one. Okay, when finish this course, you can analyze and design a simple structure. On the third, when you design the structure, you go back, use the knowledge from chapter six and the knowledge from chapter seven, you're gonna design the structure in order the maximum shear stress, the sigma max that occur on the structure. That is going to be the Mmax. That is going to be the maximum moment time y. Y is the distance from the neutral axis to the point of maximum stress. Usually is going to be y max and divided by I. Okay, in the design, Y is the section of the property, section property, and I also property section. By doing this, you may really like it to be I over Y. We call it section modulus, and it's going to be M maximum divided by sigma max. And by the design, we cannot do sigma max. We're going to set sigma max to be equal to sigma allowed. And sigma allowed, if the structure is the steel, is going to be sigma yielding divided by factor of safety. So this one, you know, the problem will provide you sigma allowable. So you can determine the section modulus, but based on the step I discussed before, you can find this one correctly. You got to determine the Mmax correctly. The way you do determine the Mmax by draw the shear diagram and draw the moment diagram from the previous example. What do you have is the simple beam subjected to 10 kilonewton. You got the reaction of 5 kilonewton and 5 kilonewton, 2 meter on the left and 2 meter on the right. So you can draw this diagram, is called shear diagram, and you also can draw the moment diagram. They are the diagram between the shear force and the distance measured from the start to the end. Okay, by doing this and by your previous knowledge, you got 5 kilonewton here. So this is going to be plus 5. There is no uniform load. So the slope, the dV by dx is 0. And this is 10 kilonewton. It's going to down by minus 10 plus 5. So it's going to be minus 5. And since over here there is no slope, that is going to be dV by dx equal to 0. Over here is upward 5 kilonewton. This is going to be the shear diagram. And you get the Vmax equal to plus minus 5 kilonewton. Okay, I use this opportunity to review your previous knowledge. Okay, and then this is pin, this is roller. The moment over here is 0. The moment over here is 0. Okay, and then what we have is the slope over here. The dm by dx is going to be the shear. It's going to be plus 5. and the moment over here, moment at this point minus moment at this point of zero, that is going to be equal to this area. That is 5 times 2. That is going to be 10 kilonewton meter. That is going to be the moment over here. And then since this is zero and the curve must be in this one because this is dm by dx equal to the shear over here of minus 5. And you can check the moment over here. Moment here minus 10, that is equal to the area over here, that is going to be minus 5 times 2. So the M is going to be 0 kilonewton meter. So go back and draw the shear review, the knowledge of drawing the shear diagram and moment diagram without the moment maximum occur over here. This is going to be the M max. If you calculate it wrong, you will get the wrong answer. And then you cannot find the cross section properly. Okay. And then if you find it correctly, you got to check the section has enough shear capacity. So from the Vmax that you has here, okay, that is going to produce the tau max equal to Vmax Q over IT. And this one must be less than or equal to the tau allowable. This one. If it not, you got to redesign the section. Okay, that is going to be the third problem. And then under the application of the force, even though this one, and then if you put the force at the middle, I suppose to use this one is better. If you put the force at the middle, the beam will deform. Okay. And the deformation, the deformation of the beam must be very small. Follow the linear elastic behavior again. You draw the beam over here is subjected to 10 kilonewton. And this is pin, this is roller. And under this force, this beam will have the deformation like this, okay? Since the force is at the middle, the deformation of this beam is going to be symmetric, okay? Oops, sorry, how come it's happened very often like this? And then you're gonna get the deformation over here. That is going to be V max. We're going to have the equation of this Vmax from the deflection table. And if you have a number, 2 or 3 or 4 loading, you're going to combine the deflection together by using the principle of superposition. We mentioned this in the chapter 4. Go back and take a look at that. And then Vmax must be less than the allowable deflection set up by the psi code. Okay, it's maybe L over 240 if the beam has no wall under it. But if your beam has the wall under it, the allowable is going to be L over 360. That means what? If you have the wall, the divider is larger to reduce the allowable deflection. So this one will set for the V allowable, okay? And then if it is okay, following this one, the section is big enough. But if the Vmax larger than V allow, you got to determine the section, or you got to redesign the section to get a bigger one. Okay, following this, first design the beam basis on the MAC. You get a section of the beam. Check it with the shear. If it pass, it's okay. If not, redesign it. You're going to get a bigger one. Okay, like a section like this, bigger one. Okay, and then check with the deflection. If it pass, it's okay. If it won't, redesign it. You will get the bigger one. Okay, and the last one, we're going to talking about the column. Okay, the column. When we talking about the column in chapter one, the column is the member of the structure that subjected to the compression. If the column is short, okay, it's going to fail by the material failure. The short column, short, the short column is the column fail by the yielding stress. That's study in the chapter one. But for the long column is different. When you compress it, it's going to buckle. Okay, this called buckle. Release the force, it's rebound back. Buckle, rebound back. Buckle, rebound back. That is called buckling of the column. It occur in the long column. And then you have the equation to determine the critical load. It's going to be sigma critical going to pi square E divided by L over R square. And then what we have, this equation is also can be used to determine the axial compressive load. Okay, that is going to be P critical. Since you have sigma equal to P over A, so P critical is going to be sigma critical times A. That is going to be the load that the column can be resist before it's buckle. Okay, and then if the structure subjected to a given load, you can determine the factor of safety by what? By put the P critical and then divided by the P that act on our structure to determine the factor of safety. Ajahn, that's quite a lot. No, that's not quite a lot. It's just on one page. And then we have 6 weeks to work on these things. And when you finish this, you will be able to finish this course mechanics of material. You can design the task. Okay, that means you can design the loop. And then you can design the column that support the roof, okay? And then you also can design the beam, okay? That's taking the floor, okay? Okay, at the end of this course, you supposed to be, for example, design analysis and design the task, okay? And then this task will support by the column, okay? And this column will have the beam to connect it at the four level. And then your structure may have another column that may be connected to the footing of this structure. Okay. And how about the floor? Okay. If you have the precast slab, okay, the precast slab is equivalent to the beam. So you may be able to put the slab, okay, onto your beam to build your simple house. So after finish this course, this is the byproduct that you supposed to analyze and decide, be able to this kind of structural element include truss and also the connection and then the beam, also the floor over here on the top, and then the column. Okay, that's only for the second years you may be able to do this kind of work. And then let me that's 40 minutes already, go to the detail of this one. As you may see later, okay, you may come by doing this, you must be determine the reaction. Okay, that is going to be, this is A sub Y, this is A sub X, this is two force member. Okay, you can has this one for F sub BC. So can you do it? You can, you do it. I like you guys to go back, try to just determine it. And then after you find this one, they ask you to cut at point E. Okay, and then let you guys draw another free body diagram based on the A sub X, A sub Y, and the applied force. And this is about 2 or 3 years ago problem. They ask you to determine the moment, okay, the shear and the normal force. This is the old knowledge. Please go back and review it. And later they ask you to determine the stress due to the end, the normal stress due to the moment, and the shear stress due to the shear force, and you will get the, again, stress element. By doing this, you're going to have the normal stress in the X direction, and shear is downward. You're going to get the sigma sub X and tau sub XY. That is the problem of problem one in 2D. You also have the problem one, but in 3D. Okay, this problem going to be harder. You must be able to draw the structure in 3 dimension. Okay, and you got to practice a lot to be able to do the analysis of this thing. This is going to be the portion that I cut from this structure. Okay, it's a kind of column subjected to the force of 80 kilonewton. And then this is up on this, the section over here that you cut, is going to have this kind of section, and it's going to have the centroid. So you guys gonna determine the force due to the 80 kilonewton force and also determine the moment. Okay, this is going to be the N and V. But for the example, if Ajahn provide you with another force, for example, if this one is 60 kilonewton, based upon this, not only the normal force and bending moment, you also gonna have this one for the shear. Okay, there is a number of problem, but it's going to be in three dimension. And some years, Ajahn also like to check your knowledge. Okay, some people just concentrated on the 2D, but the what so called the learning objective that's come from your employer, okay, they also require you guys to be able to work on the three dimensional problem. Okay, Ajahn, for some year only 2D, why the employer is okay? Because if you are the mechanical engineering student, you still have more courses working on this kind of problem, and it's going to be a little bit, no, not a little bit, it's going to be harder. Also, in civil engineering, some problem also, you need to have the knowledge working on the 3D. So I like you guys to do the same thing, determine the internal force and moment, the N, the M, and the V, okay? N, V, this is force and the moment. And then the stress of stress, something like this, at the given point, okay? And then come to the problem number two. From the what's so called the stress element, they're going to provide you in this way. This is going to be the stress element. Based upon this, you guys must know this is going to be X and Y axis. So based on this stress element, you got sigma sub X equal to plus 4 mega Pascal. And you got sigma sub Y in this direction. Okay, that is going to be plus 2 mega Pascal. They are intention. But for the shear stress, okay, if the shear stress point downward, it opposite with the Y axis, this one will have tau sub XY equal to minus 7 mega Pascal. Okay, and then they're going to ask you about what I'm saying. What is going to be sigma 1, sigma 2, and their associated angle, sigma P1, sigma P2. That's used to predict the failure of the material, such as cast iron. Okay, and they also asking you to determine plus minus tau maximum that occur with the sigma average. Okay, that's used to predict the failure of the material such as steel or aluminum. And then they also ask you for a given theta, what is going to be sigma sub X palm, sigma sub Y palm, tau sub X palm, Y palm. For example, they ask you to rotate this one for theta. This is going to be positive angle. Clockwise is the positive. And then you have the what's so called the Mohr circle. The detail of the Mohr circle gonna be discussed later. But by doing this, the stress element, you're supposed to dock it over here, but you cannot, because if you dock it over here, everything gonna be very bad, mess up, okay? And then this is going to be sigma sub x prime, sigma sub y prime. You will be able to determine them. And this is going to be tau sub x prime y prime. And this is going to be the second problem, okay? And then the third problem is over here. And the first thing, you got to be able to draw the shear diagram and moment diagram. Before you can draw the moment diagram and shear diagram for sure, you got to be able to determine the A sub Y and B sub Y. Don't worry, this A sub X is going to be zero, okay? And based upon this, since the load is close to the B, for sure, B sub Y is going to be larger than the A sub Y, okay? And then based upon this, you may do a sketch. Okay, this is A sub Y. It's going to be positive A sub Y. I don't know what value it is, okay? But we can find it easily by drawing free body diagram and use. But the shear diagram will be something like this. Why? Because this one, no slope. The dV by the X is zero. dV by the X, the slope of this one is zero. So this is going to be A sub Y. And then this is 60. This is dV by the X is going to be minus 60. This one going to be dropped down here to be what? To be minus B sub Y. And then it's going to be upward. If you guys catch what I'm saying here, I think you have some knowledge from the previous course. If not, you got to go back and review about it. And this is going to be zero shear force. Now, since this is pinned again, this is roller, and there is no external moment. So the moment over here is zero. The moment over here is zero. Now you have the dm by dx equal to, sorry, equal to v, equal to v, equal to v. That means it's going to be equal to plus a sub y. And this is going to be plus a sub y constant slope. When the slope is constant, you got the linear line. Okay, the slope is constant. And then over here, you can determine the value of it. Okay, the M over here minus zero equal to this one. This is going to be 2A sub Y. You put the number into it, you can determine it easily. And then this is positive. So the value of this one supposed to be get a little bit bigger. And at this point, there is one important thing. The dm by dx equal to zero at the point of the maximum. Okay, the slope is zero over here. At the point of minimum, the slope is zero. So this one going to be the maximum. And then what we have, the curve going to be reduced, the slope, okay, until this is going to be the curve line until it reach over here. The dm by dx going to be minus b sub y. So go back, review about it, and you can see from this one, V max is going to be minus B sub Y kilonewton. Do the computation, what is going to be be supplied. And then Mx is going to be kilonewton meter. And then you may use this Mx to maximum moment to determine the required section modulus sigma equal to My over I. So you take the I up, take the Y down. You have this one is Mx. This one gonna be sigma allowed, and this one gonna be required section modulus. And if this one is the steel beam, okay, you can use the steel table to select a proper section. Okay, this one, the S required must be smaller than the section modulus from the steel table. And that's going to be the answer over here. And then for the problem number four, they're going to ask you under this, this one gonna have the deflection like this. They may give you a point to determine the maximum deflection. And it's going to be in a form of long equation. And then you put the location into it. You can compute the Vmax. And this Vmax, again, must be less than equal to allowable deflection, such as L over 240 or L over 360. That is going to be problem number four, okay? And then I spent nearly 1 hour because my objective is clear to let you guys get used to with the problem that you going to have in the final examination, because we have a lot of things to learn. So the learning curve gonna be very steep. There are a lot of things that you gonna learn. Again, this is going to be the column with the length of 7 meters. That is really big because 7 meters is kind of a two-story building. Usually the building is about 3 or 4 meters for one story. Okay, that's pretty long one. And this has the I section. Most of the section, the steel section, come from the steel table, has this I section, because I section is the one of the most effective section, okay? When we use it, it means it's going to produce large I with low A. That means it's going to require small material to get the large moment of inertia. When you get large moment of inertia, stress is going to be lower. The deflection is going to be lower because stress is going to be My over I, okay? And this one also comes from the equation that divided by the moment of inertia. And then is subjected to the force of P, okay? And it's fixed over here, okay? And then it's supported by the cable on the top. Then they ask you to, to think about the buckle shape. You fix it, you pin it on the top, okay? That is going to be the shape like this. So that's why they ask you guys since this one cannot move in the x direction, so you put your ruler and you can draw the barking shape in if you look in this direction. Okay, it's going to be something like this, and then in the opposite direction. In the opposite, since there is nothing hold the top of the beam in the y direction. Oops, sorry. What we have this direction of deflection of the column gonna be like this one. Ajahn, this is very confusing. Calm down. We're going to study about it. Over here, I'm reviewing what you're supposed to learn later. That is going to be one about x-axis, okay? And another one about y-axis. So you will get the shape like this. And then later, you determine the backing load. You got to determine the P critical. The P critical is going to be sigma critical A. So before you determine this, you got to determine the sigma critical. Sigma critical is going to be pi square E divided by KL over R square. This is the KL over R square. Okay. And then you can do the computation to determine such as the P allowable, in which P allowable gonna be P critical divided by factor of safety. This one, they provide you the factor of safety. Sometimes they ask you to determine the factor of safety when they provide you the value of the load P. So it depends on how they asking you. That is going to be a lot of things. Okay. And I should stop over here for 5 minutes to let you guys refresh yourself. Come to what we are going to study before we are going to talking about what we are going to study. Let's go back. What do we have? We study for 5 chapters. And for this 5 chapters, we're talking about the normal stress. Okay. This normal stress is occur due to the internal normal force. That means you use the free body diagram and the equation of equilibrium to determine it. And then the material that we are studying here is the deformable material. That's why we determine the normal strength. And then it's going to be the deformation divided by its original range. This is going to be, for example, chapter 1, and this is going to be from the chapter 2, and then we have this one. This is Hooke's law. This is on the Hooke's law. We're going to use this assumption of linear, elastic, and small deformation, okay, across this course. That means what? The stress you obtain must be smaller than the yielding stress from the steel. And the maximum deformation going to be less than the allowable deformation. And based on this, you may write this equation to determine the deformation of the elastic two force member. That is going to be in the chapter 4. So we have this one from chapter 3. We have this one from chapter 2. We have this one from chapter 1. And this one, usually we talking about the structural member. And the structural member we talking about usually is only two force member. What's going to be the two force member? That is going to be the member of the task. That's why I said you'll be able to analyze and decide the roof of a small structure. And then we come to the direct shear force. The direct shear force going to involve with the connection. And then we have the single and double shear force that's going to produce the shear stress. Okay, so the V can be single shear force and the double shear force. And also for the torsion, the shaft of the automobile transferring the torsion from the engine to the wheel of the car is also provide the shear stress, but this is going to call the torsional shear stress. It's not this one. This is the direct shear stress. Okay, and then you may use this one for various shaft structure. It's important for the mechanical engineering, automotive engineering, aerospace engineering, and also civil engineering use the shaft to drill the saw and lock to export it or to build the part of the structure. And now we move our attention not only the two force member, we come to the flexural member. And when we talking about the flexural member, we are going to talking about the beam and the frame. The beam is the structure that's only taking the transverse load, but the frame may be more compact than that. Frame may be pinned over here and roller over here, subjected to the force. So the frame maybe include the beam and include the column like this. Okay. And since your structure subjected to the force like this, it's going to bend. It's going to bend. Okay. It's going to bend like this. And then the stress occur on this one, you may call it flexural or bending stress. And the flexural and bending stress can be determined from this equation. And then the beam also has the transverse. This is called the transverse shear force. And the transverse shear force produce the transverse shear stress, okay, by this equation. So by the meantime, within this 2 weeks, you guys going to use the pink equation and this Liking equation. And you guys supposed to remember the whole equation here, but not enough. You still have more later. And based on this, this equation can be relied into tau t. You take the t up. That is going to call q. Q is going to be called shear flow. Shear flow is important when we analyze the composite section, because at the connection of the composite section, we will use equation to analyze and decide the connection of the composite section later. So coming into this. This is the example of a bridge, okay? And most of the bridge has the beam, okay? And also has the column. This beam is the subject of our study. Usually, even though the beam is in two dimension or three dimension, usually you may, by this picture, this beam is in three dimension, but we draw the diagram, shear diagram, moment diagram, elastic curve, the deflected diagram based on this red line that's passing through the centroid of the section. And then if you imagine the force over here, okay, will transfer from the above four and joint is a small beam and act on the beam like this. And also the beam has the, not only the point load here, has the uniform load. So most of the time you may combine them together to be uniformly distributed load across this beam. And following this one, you may draw the model of the beam. There's an overhanging beam that is going to be the beam like this. That is subjected to the force. And then under this force, you may imagine your structure will deform something like this, okay? This call later on the chapter 11, we call this one as the elastic curve, or if you put this one by the force, it's going to bend. This is going to call the elastic curve. And this elastic curve is caused due to the bending, okay? Gandat in Thai, cause the elastic curve. But before you can determine the elastic curve, you got to be able to draw the, again, shear diagram and moment diagram. That means the first thing, you got to go back, review the drawing of the diagrams based on the graphic method. We will discuss this later, okay? And then under the force, you got to understand the deformation of the beam or bending, the green light over here. That is the deformation due to the transfer load. This force, let's say it's going to be 10 kilonewton per meter. This called the transfer load. That's caused the bending or fracture of the beam. And finally, this is going to be what we have discussed. You're supposed to be able to analyze and decide the beam or the composite beam, okay? Usually the composite beam is the beam has the composite section, or for the beam is maybe the beam with the rectangular section. And based on this, I have some problem for you guys to work on. And again, draw the shear diagram, moment diagram. Based on this one, I like you guys to work on these two methods in order to let you guys to review the engine static. And then just determine the maximum compressive stress and maximum tensile stress. When you bend the structure, even though you bend your finger, you can see on the bottom, it's going to get tension on the top is going to be get the compression, is going to change on the bottom, is going to elongate. Okay, that means it's going to produce the bending like this. This is due to the positive moment, bending like this. However, if you bend this one like this, it's going to opposite. This is due to the negative moment. Ah, okay, at this point, I supposed to tell you about this by putting the positive moment, you get this kind of deformation. And then if you put the member in the negative moment, you get this one. They are in opposite. This one going to be in compression. This one going to be in tension. And then the last one is going to be a little bit more complex. Ask you guys to determine the force that can apply to this structure. Again, there is no design on this chapter 6. Yes, but I will teach you about the design, but most of the time the design concentrated on chapter 12. But we will touch it. And usually the problem number one will involve with this kind of problem to draw the stress element. I like you guys to go back, do a lot of work, review 1, 2, and 3. All of them come from the engineering static, okay? And then physical meaning of deflection. Usually, if we bend it and you have the rubber beam, and you draw the line, the square shape on the rubber beam, and then you bend it, you will get the deformation of the structure. Since the moment is positive, the top going to be in compression, the bottom is going to be in tension. What I'm saying is there is about this one. There is no compression and no tension. That means over here, there is no stress. So based on this, if I draw the stress, the top portion is going to be in compression. Is going to get shorter, and the bottom is going to be in tension. By doing this, this one is going to be in tension and is going to get elongation, and on the top is going to get the contraction, and in between there is no deformation over here. It's going to be no deformation. And then we call this as the neutral plane. Neutral plane. Now it's going to be the plane on the section of the beam that has no stress. The sigma equal to 0. That is the physical meaning of this. Okay, you may read more from the textbook. And then for a simple experiment, the rubber beam subjected to the positive moment, this is contraction, this is elongation, that is the neutral over here, is changed from negative to positive. So over here, there is a 0 value, okay? And then based on this one, we can do the development, what's so called the precast beam. In Thailand, the labor cost is getting higher and higher because not much people like working as the worker. So we're going to develop the machine to work in the construction industry. Not only develop the machine for this work, we also need to adapt all knowledge to produce the what's so called the concrete product that will let us work easier, more convenient, faster, reduce the construction cost. That means we do the precast beam. And then this precast beam can be fabricated and actually manufactured in the industry or in the factory. And then it will ship to the construction site and install in the structure easily. There is a lot of precast product such as in the old day precast slab. Now we have the precast beam and we also has the precast column and also we have the precast wall. It's like a Lego. You understand? It's like a kit stuff. Just put it together, join it, and build it. Okay. And this is like a development. Okay. We like to know under the force that we apply here, transfer to here, how much this one gonna be. We have the theory. Okay. We use the design code to do the computation, but we don't sure how much the accuracy of the design code, because in the manufacturing of thing, there is a lot of variable. Okay, that's why we must do the experiment to check the result. Okay, by setting this one as the reference. Okay, this is precast. This is reinforced concrete. This the beam have one PC reinforcement, two PC reinforcement, three PC reinforcement, four PC reinforcement. And then we compare the result. We test it until it caused the crack over here. We compare the result with the equation that we use for the design code. Okay, based upon this, you choose be able to what to at least to the shear diagram and also moment diagram to find the expect Vmax and Mmax under the force P and use the equation to decide it. And then you cast it in the factory and then you put it into the testing rig like this and check this result. That's you test with the result that you use in the design code. And if match, thing going to be okay. And if larger, if this testing result is larger, it's okay. But if it's smaller, you got to modify what you supposed to know. Okay, I'd like you guys to go back and draw the shear diagram and the moment diagram of this beam. Okay, and then we going to prevent based upon the the study of this course. We going to prevent the failure of this simple beam. We don't like it to be have large deformation. We don't like it to have yielding failure, ductile failure, or brittle failure. Okay, we're going to have to decide it to perform its function properly. Function properly. That is our main thing. And this thing also, you're supposed to be able to prevent it. This is the failure of the beam of a bridge in the Beijing area, China. That's occurred, that is about 11 years ago. This is due to the weight of the tug is maybe so large and cause the failure of one span of the bridge and cause the domino effect to the other bridge nearby, and that's gonna cause big failure. So you got to prevent it. Okay, when you has the beam and then you bend it, okay, you supposed to imagine by bending the deformation of the beam supposed to be like this. The above, the top gonna be in compression and the material gonna be in contraction. The bottom gonna be in tension. The material is gonna be in elongation. And since the study is linear, the material is going to be taking the moment with the linear elastic behavior. So the stress occur over here proportional to the strength. And from the textbook, the distribution of the strain will be like this, causing the distribution of the stress over here. And since the stress proportion to the Y, okay, the Y is here, the stress, which we call the bending or fractural normal stress, is going to be computed by using this equation when the M is the moment, Y is the distance measured from the neutral axis, the axis that has no deformation, the axis that has stress equal to zero to a given point. And then by doing this, we may call Y as the distance from the neutral axis to, let's say, a given point. And then I is going to be the moment of inertia. If the section has this rectangular and this is X and this is Y, we have the I sub X equal to, over here is the B, the width, and this is the height cube over 12. Do you guys remember about it? I like you guys to, let's say, remember this one first. And then the maximum stress that's occur on a section is going to be depend on the distance Y. If the section is not symmetry like this one, this section is, oh sorry, this section is symmetry. When section is symmetry like this, the stress that occur on the top is going to be the equal to the stress occur on the bottom. Since when you measure Y T, and you measure Y bottom. They are equal, but when the your structure may be in the form something like this, you may compute the centroid of the section, and the centroid of the section will be in this location. So when you measure YT, the YT will be larger than YB. So based on this figure, we use this C to determine the maximum normal stress. So be careful about the Y. And again, the structure is in linear elastic. That we can compute the strain from this stress for the maximum strain, or from this stress for the strain in a given point. And then type of the problem, actually the big one, and usually we are going to have it on the problem number one, is analysis. Usually just use this equation to determine the stress. But before you use this equation, you got to find the moment. So you got to draw the shear diagram, and you got to draw the moment diagram to work on this problem. Ajahn, there is this one, maybe 1.8. Just find the stress. And there is 1.B also, actually. Yes, 1.B, you determine the Mmax. Mmax is equal to sigma max time I over C. And from Mmax, you can use to determine the applied loads on the structure. But we didn't have this kind of problem to ask you much, okay? Because most of the time when we have the final examination, the problem is too much already, and you guys have other things. So we put a basic one for you guys. That is going to be 1.8 from the problem number one. And then if you may recall from the start of this lecture, we have the design problem. Again, the design problem we teach in the chapter 6-7, and we will focus it again in the chapter 11 and 12 for you guys to work on the problem 3 and 4 of the midterm examination. Again, you got to be able to draw the shear diagram and moment diagram for the design of the beam. That means you got to determine what going to be the width and what is going to be the height of this beam, okay? And then come back to this one. It's going to be just typical knowledge about what you're going to analyze or design of the beam. The first thing, draw the shear diagram, moment diagram, find the Vmax, find the Mmax. We start by using actually the Vmax. No, using the Mmax. We use the Mmax to design the section actually. And then we check the section to take the Vmax. It all passes the section big enough. And then we check for the deflection. Okay, if it passes, it's okay. If it won't pass, we do the redesign. That is just the simple step of the design. And then we have three main types of beam in this subject. First, we may call it simple beam, simply supported beam, cantilever beam, and overhanging beam. So this beam can subject to various type of loading. The load that's applied to the structure can be point load, can be uniform load, and can be the external moment. And that's going to involve in the graphical method that we use to draw the shear diagram and moment diagram later. And this is the picture of the pin connection in order you guys to have the real world structure. And usually the structure when we build it, okay, is going to be very complicated, involving various of structural members and connections. We may have this one, we call it joints or small beam. That is going to transfer the force into what's so called the beam. Okay, if it is the very big beam, we call it girder. And then the force from this one will transfer to this one. This one, we call it column. And then between the joint is supposed to have the force put on the top of it. That is going to be the structural system. And this picture show you the cantilever beam. That's cantilever out of the column, okay? And usually it's set the connection over here assumed as the fixed support. If you just consider it as a structural member. And this one is has the overhanging portion over here, okay? And this beam very huge. When we're talking about this is the size of a man, of a worker, this beam is like 2 times taller than the worker. Again, we can work on this. Size convention, if you cut the structure, you have the beam, again, from the previous example, 10 kilonewton, and this is 5 kilonewton, 5 kilonewton, for this structure. When you cut it, again, the moment on this side assumed to be positive. The shear on this side assumed to be positive, okay? This is on this, we will use it and we will get the same shear and moment diagram. Just follow this one. And drawing the shear diagram, moment diagram, this will leave you on anything static. Okay, if your structure has the point load like this, you got to separate the what the coordinate into two portions. But if your beam just subjected to continuous force, and by this kind of beam, you may only cut the beam once, and you may use all of coordinate to compute for the moment and shear. But for the point load, you can, because the point load separate the beam into two portions, so you got to set the coordinate to be x1 and x2. And then x1 can use from the start to the middle, can use from 0 to 2. And then for the x2, it's going to use between B and C. So the x2 gonna start from 2 meter until 4 meter. You got to understand what we set the length for the coordinate also and use it properly. So by doing this, I like you guys to go back and can you draw this kind of shear diagram and moment diagram, and then you may get a map the we max is going to be plus minus 2.5 kilonewton. And I'd like you guys to, again, review this one. The free body diagram of the beam C is pinned. It's going to be C sub X, C sub Y. A is the roller. We are going to have only A sub Y. So we use summation of X sub X equal to zero. So C sub X is zero. And then you may take the moment at point A. So C sub Y is going to be in counterclockwise direction. It's going to be in this direction with this one of 8 meter. So C sub Y times 8. And the resultant force due to the uniformly distributed load, that is going to be the area, 50 kilonewton per meter times 8 meter. That's one going to has the clockwise rotation. That's going to times by 4. So you get this equation. You get C sub Y. Summation of X sub Y equal to 0. A sub Y plus this one. Now, this one is 200 kilonewton equal to 400. So A sub Y equal to 200. I like to make a note on this due to the symmetry, okay, of this beam. The A sub Y is going to be equal to the C sub Y. Sometimes you don't need to compute like this. You may set due to the symmetry of the beam. Due to the symmetry of the beam, we have A sub Y equal to C sub Y equal to 8 times 5 divided by 2. So that is going to be 200 kilonewton. You may do something like this but you got to provide this listening. And then you may cut it, just one cut due to the continuous function. You may get this one as the M and V. So use it from 0 here and 4 meter here, 8 meter here. Since this is X meter, so this is the length of your coordinate. Summation of F sub Y equal to 0 V. Let's say that one is positive. Okay, we have what? V plus 50X equal to 200. So we get this equation. And then we take moment about here, okay? And the moment in this direction is positive, okay? We have the moment plus 50x times x over 2. This is going to be x over 2. And then over here is going to be x equal to 200x. You get the equation here. And then M is going to be this one. And by doing this, you just draw the shear diagram and the moment diagram. And then by doing this, we got the relationship V and M. dV by dx equal to minus 50 equal to distributed load, minus of the distributed load. dM by dx, you dip here is 200. This is minus 50x. That is going to be the shear. And then the over here, this is zero. And the maximum moment occur when slope equal to zero. You may get this one, as you already know, just the review of it. Okay, and then you got the slope from the shear. You got slope of the shear diagram from the problem. You got the slope from the moment diagram from the shear diagram basis upon this. And then the graphical method said dV by dx equal to minus W, dm by dx equal to V. And by the first equation, you get the delta V equal to minus of the area under the distributed force between the considering point and again the change of the moment between two points is going to be the integration. The integration is the area of the shear diagram between those two points. And for the point load is downward, the delta is negative, is upward, the delta is positive. The moment the clockwise produce the positive moment produce the increase. So the counterclockwise going to produce the negative or decrease in the delta M. Okay, so this is the whole picture. I'd like you guys to go back and check about it. And another thing, for the point load, there is no uniform load. Shear is the constant. The moment is the linear function. Okay, that's going to help you check when you draw the shear moment diagram. For the uniformly distributed load, this is 50 kilonewton meter. The shear is going to be the linear and the moment is going to be the quadratic. Okay, this is the function. You go back from the previous slide and you can see the picture. If the load is linear, you can see the shear is quadratic. The moment is the cubic polynomial. And you can see the order of the shear is one order more than the load. The order of the moment is one order larger than the shear force. Okay, and by using this, I assign you guys to go back and work on this problem to review your knowledge. And also, not enough, you got to go back to review the centroid of the section, how to determine the centroid. If the section is double symmetry, the centroid is going to be at the center of the section. But if the section is only one, have only one symmetric axis, now something like this, okay, only one symmetric axis, the centroid is not going to be at the center of the section. So you got to go back and review about it, okay? And composite section can be both plus and cut, okay? Plus and cut, whatsoever you combine them. And go back to this one and try to review it by yourself from the lecture note. And the moment of inertia, you know that this one is the most efficient. That's why the industry, steel industry in Thailand, we have Siam Yamato from the SCG. We have the SSI, Sabia Steel Industry. We have BSBM, Bangsapan Steel Mill. Most of the steel table will have this kind of composite section. It can be I, it can be T, it can be C, it can be L, okay? And the second efficiency, efficient section is going to be B. But see what? The section can be bent easily. That's why we don't have much about using this section in the beam like this. And most of the time, if we use this, is the timber beam, okay? And this one for the steel beam. Timber beam. And again, this is the reason why A is the most efficient, is the best section. And I let you guys to go back to review everything of this. It's your duty to review your previous knowledge to get the learning objective. There is a number of examples in this slide, okay? And again, if you cannot compute a correct I, you cannot compute the stress correctly based upon this physical meaning. We have the, again, the equation for the fractural stress in the form like this. If you cannot compute I correctly, you got to have the problem. And since the Y and the I also based on the centroid of the section, so the centroid is important, okay? Even though you got to be able to determine the moment correctly from the cut section or from the shear moment diagram. So I supposed to finish over here on the 13th lecture and like you guys to focus on the problem we going to work, okay? I'm going to have all these kind of problem analysis 1.A, analysis 1.B, even though the design from the next lecture. But I like you guys from the first problem, we will focus on the design. But for the third problem, we will focus the first on the analysis. The third will be on the design. This is going to be the big picture. And next time when I come, we will start from this one. And again, you have a lot of work to review your setup. Hope you guys arrange the time for that. Okay, so have a good day. Bye-bye.